In this video, we're going to look at microbial respiration. Microbial respiration is part of microbial metabolism. And if you remember, metabolism is part breaking down, which is catabolism, and part building up, which is anabolism. And this occurs in 5 basic steps. First, the microorganism needs to transport molecules inside. Then, the cell uses enzymes to break down these molecules. That releases energy and building block pieces, which are called precursor metabolites. The energy is stored as ATP. Then, the cell uses the stored ATP energy and the precursor metabolites to build new cell parts. And then, when it has enough of the pieces to make its cell, it reproduces. And that's what the microbe wants to do. It wants to reproduce. So basically, it goes through these 5 steps over and over again all the time. Now, our video is going to focus on the first 3 steps, which is the respiration part, the catabolism part. So before we look at that in detail, let's look at some of the behind-the-scenes information. So the first thing is enzymes and coenzymes. Enzymes make all the reaction happen in cells. So remember, we described those as the machines that makes the cell work. Coenzymes are nucleotides, and they're going to be our energy carriers. And they're carrying energy in the form of electrons, but they'll also carry protons. All this is part of redox reactions, if you learned about that in chemistry. And during catabolism, as molecules are broken down, the protons and electrons are released. Electrons, we want to start thinking about as the energy part. So when the molecules are broken, the electrons are released. That's the energy that's being released. But we have to be very careful with electrons because they can be toxic to DNA, so they have to be controlled very carefully or they will kill the cell. So one of our coenzymes is NAD+, and it's going to accept protons and electrons, and then it becomes NADH. NADH is able to transport those protons and electrons safely around the cell, and then it will drop them off at the electron transport chain, drops off the electrons and the protons, and goes back to the NAD+ form. So this also happens in cycles back and forth. NAD+ accepts the protons and electrons, becomes NADH. NADH transports them, drops off the protons and electrons, and goes back to NAD+. The other key background thing that we want to look for is the ATP synthase. And the ATP synthase is an enzyme that makes ATP or synthesizes ATP. And you can see in my simple sketch here that it's actually built into the cell membrane. And again, it's an enzyme. It works like a windmill to generate ATP energy. So it's kind of our amazing enzyme in our cell. But instead of wind pushing the windmill, it's the protons which are going to spin this ATP synthase. So we want to look out for those protons because in the end, they're going to spin the synthase and allow the cell to make ATP. There's more animations about this on Blackboard in the useful web links folder if you want to look at this in more detail. So now that we've looked at the background, let's look at aerobic respiration. Here is a bacterium, and you can see that there's no cell wall, just a cell membrane, just to make the video a little bit more simple. You can see also that built into the cell membrane is the electron transport chain, and this is a set of enzymes. Also, at the end of the chain are amazing enzyme, the ATP synthase. So we're going to look at how aerobic respiration occurs in the single-celled bacterium. So sometimes it doesn't have the perfect type of food. For example, it might have starch, and starch is too big to transport in. So it first has to be broken down into glucose, and then glucose is small enough to bring inside the cell. So glucose will enter the first process, which is called glycolysis. And glycolysis, again, is like a 12-step process. And there's enzymes working at every one of those 12 steps. It's basically rearranging the glucose molecule to extract the energy. Glucose is going to get broken down into pyruvate. And as this happens, protons and electrons are extracted and added to ATP and phosphate to make ATP. And NAD+ also comes in and picks up those protons and electrons and becomes NADH. Now, there's still energy left in pyruvate, so it's going to continue to the next step, which is the Krebs cycle. And the Krebs cycle, again, or by the end of the Krebs cycle, all the energy has been extracted from pyruvate, and so we're left with waste carbon, which is carbon dioxide. And there are 6 carbons in glucose, and all of the energy is extracted from that glucose, and so we have 6 molecules of carbon dioxide as a waste product. All of that electron energy is again picked up by our coenzyme NAD+, which becomes NADH. So now we have taken all the energy out of glucose, we've made a little bit of ATP, but most of the energy we have stored in the coenzyme NADH. So now NADH goes down to the electron transport chain. It's going to give up protons and electrons to the enzymes of the chain. And remember, it's really the electron that has to be carefully controlled, because that's the dangerous part. The protons are fine to float around in the cell, but the electron has to be specially handled. After NADH drops off those protons and electrons at the electron transport chain, it goes back to the NAD plus form, and then can go back to either the Krebs cycle or glycolysis and do the process over again. Now if we look back down at the protons and electrons, the electron is going to be given to the chain, and it's going to be passed from the first enzyme to the second enzyme. In that process, it gives up a little bit of energy, just enough energy to take a proton and pump it outside the cell. Then that electron is passed along to the second enzyme, gives up a little bit of energy, just enough to send a proton outside. Again, through all the enzymes of the chain until it reaches the end, that electron gives up a little bit of energy, just enough to pump the protons out of the cell. Now, after all the NADHs come down, they drop off their protons and electrons. The electrons are used to pump out the protons, and so we end up with a lot of protons on the outside of the cell, and this forms the proton gradient. Now, those protons are positively charged, so because of that charge, they can't cross back into the cell by themselves, so we provide a place for them to go through, which is the ATP synthase. Remember, that was our windmill, and instead of wind pushing it, it's the protons that push the ATP synthase, and this allows the cell to take ADP and connect a phosphate back to make ATP. So this is aerobic respiration. The part that makes it aerobic is that even though we extracted all the energy out of that electron, we can't let it sit there by itself, because it could still be dangerous and it could still damaged DNA. So we need a final electron acceptor. In aerobic respiration, that final electron acceptor is oxygen, and through a couple of step process, after the oxygen accepts that final electron, it's detoxified into water. So that is aerobic respiration. It works very well. It requires oxygen as the final electron acceptor, and with the ATP synthase is able to get about 36 molecules of ATP. The next process is anaerobic respiration, and anaerobic respiration is exactly like aerobic respiration. It still has glycolysis, it has the Krebs cycle, it breaks down glucose to extract the protons and electrons and sends them to the electron transport chain. The electrons move along the chain to pump out the protons, and then the proton gradient spins the ATP synthase to make ATP. The key difference is that final electron in anaerobic respiration is not accepted by oxygen. Instead, it's accepted usually by either nitrogen or sulfur. The sulfur in this example combines with that final electron, and instead of forming water, forms hydrogen sulfide. So the key difference with anaerobic respiration is that there is a different electron acceptor in place of oxygen, usually nitrogen or sulfur. It accepts that final electron and detoxifies it. Now, usually we only see anaerobic respiration in bacteria, so you may have never heard of this before, or you may have heard fermentation called anaerobic respiration, but it's its own separate process. And again, since it has all these steps, including the ATP synthase, it's able to make a lot of ATP. Not quite as much as aerobic, because sulfur isn't as good of an electron acceptor as oxygen, so it's a little bit less, more like 30 ATPs instead of 36, but still a very high amount of ATP using anaerobic respiration. Our last process is glycolysis combined with fermentation. This is another anaerobic process, but it's not quite the same as anaerobic respiration or aerobic respiration. It does not require oxygen, so that makes it similar to anaerobic respiration, but it makes much less energy than anaerobic respiration. So we have our simple bacterium again, and same process to start. Starch is broken down to glucose. Glucose enters the cell, and glucose goes through the process of glycolysis. This part is always the same in all cells. All cells have the ability to do glycolysis. In glycolysis, glucose broken down to pyruvate, NAD plus coenzyme, and some ADP and phosphate come in and are converted to NADH and ATP. Or ATP and NADH. So again, they accept the protons and electrons that were broken out of glucose, and then glucose becomes pyruvate. In this process, though, since the cell does not have oxygen, it cannot use the Krebs cycle. So instead, it has to recycle the NADH, because if you remember, in aerobic respiration, NADH was recycled at the electron transport chain. But since this cell doesn't use the electron transport chain, it needs a different way to recycle NADH. Because in order to make energy in glycolysis, it's got to have NAD+, so that NADH must be recycled. And so in this case, pyruvate is sent through the steps of fermentation. Pyruvate becomes the final electron acceptor. It gets turned into either alcohol with carbon dioxide or acid. And these are considered waste products of fermentation. So the pyruvate is converted to alcohol and acid because it accepts the protons and electrons back from NADH, which allows NADH to be recycled back to NAD+. NAD+ can then go back to glycolysis, so that the cell can continue to make ATP. So notice that fermentation doesn't give the cell any extra energy. All of its ATP energy comes through glycolysis. All that fermentation does is give it a way to continue glycolysis by recycling NADH. And it actually is another negative effect, because those waste products of alcohol and acid eventually will be toxic to the cell. The cell has to do this, though, in order to continue making ATP, because it must recycle the NADH back to NAD+. So let's compare all these three. So aerobic respiration is aerobic because it uses oxygen as the final electron acceptor. It uses the steps of glycolysis, the Krebs cycle, the electron transport chain, and the ATP synthase. And since it can use the ATP synthase, it makes a good high amount of ATP, up to 36 ATPs per molecule of glucose. Anaerobic respiration is an anaerobic process. Instead of oxygen, it uses nitrogen or sulfur as the final electron acceptor. It still has those same four steps of glycolysis, the Krebs cycle, electron transport chain, and ATP synthase. And again, with that ATP synthase, it can still make a high amount of energy, about 30 ATPs for every glucose molecule. Our last option is glycolysis on fermentation. This is also an anaerobic process. And instead of an inorganic acceptor like aerobic and anaerobic, it uses an organic molecule like pyruvate for the final electron acceptor. Only two steps in this process: glycolysis to make the ATP, and then fermentation to recycle NADH. Fermentation only makes 2 ATP for every glucose molecule, and that happens in glycolysis. Thank you.